Hi, welcome to part 6 of the Psychoacoustic series. I've got a few more psychoacoustic phenomena to share with you, as well as a couple things that aren't technically psychoacoustic phenomena, but are more broadly speaking audio phenomena of different kinds. Part 7 of the series is going to be released at the same time, and in that part I'm going to cover updates, corrections, clarifications, and comments that you've made on the previous 5 videos in the Psychoacoustic series. You can check up there for the playlist for the entire series. Let's get into the new ones. In 1969, experimental musician, composer, and artist Alvin Lucier released a track called Sitting in a Room. For this track, he sat in a room and recited some text. He recorded this recitation, and then took that audio and played it back into the same room and recorded that. And then he took that recording and played it back again and recorded that and kept going through this iterative process. The result is that what he read aloud in the room eventually becomes so characterized by the acoustics of the space that you can't even recognize it as speech anymore. It's a really beautiful piece, and I recommend checking it out. You can see a link in the description. It turns out that Alvin Lucier passed away December of this year, 2021. So in his memory, I'd like to make my own version of this effect. What I did was to read a quote, actually from Alvin Lucier himself, played it into my own room here, along with a little bit of whistle and a hand clap, and then I repeated the same process. I'll play the clips for you now. I'll fast forward a little bit through them so you don't have to wait for the entire evolution, but if you want to hear the entire uninterrupted piece, you can find the link in the description. Careful listening is more important than making sounds happen. Careful listening is more important than making sounds happen. It's kind of wild to hear all this acoustic complexity just latent in the space that's around you. Okay, next thing. You've probably seen these videos on the internet where people try to talk while they're hearing their own voice through a microphone piped into earbuds that they're wearing at the same time. The trick is that you delay the audio, researchers suggest about 180 milliseconds, and it interrupts our speech pipeline to such a degree that we have difficulty continuing to speak. I think this is a really neat effect, so I decided to try it out on a friend of mine.
Evolution eventually led to fertilization occurring on the mother plant, rather than on the ground. Seed ferns, now extinct, were the first seed producers, followed by cycads and ginkgos, and later conifers and flowering plants. Conifers, for example, produced two sizes of cones from modified clusters of leaves with sporous sacs at the base of each leaf. Large cones produce big spores, which develop into a thallus-like structure and produce egg cells, called ovules, within the cones. The smaller cones produce tiny spores, which also develop into a thallus-like structure.
In part one, we talked about pitch circularity and rhythm circularity, and it occurred to me after making those videos that it might be kind of interesting to play with the idea of both happening at the same time. Now, if you're one of the many people who found themselves troubled by the audio examples I gave in that video, you might want to skip this part. I like them, but they can be kind of intense to hear. First, let's do one where both the tempo and the pitch increase. Now let's do one where the tempo and the pitch both decrease. Thank you. So here's where it gets a little more interesting. For this one, the tempo will increase and the pitch will decrease. And for the last permutation, the tempo will decrease and the pitch will increase. Here's another one that's not a psychoacoustic phenomena, but has some overlap. You've heard of throat singing, perhaps, or overtone singing. This is a vocal technique that has its real home in Tuva or Mongolia. It's really one of my favorite genres of folk music. If you haven't had a chance, you should check out the music of Han Hurtu or Batsirik Vanchig. There's links in the description to some really beautiful concerts of this music. You might also check out Anna Maria Ifala, who's a German woman that sings polytonal music by employing the overtone technique while she also changes the fundamental frequency of the tone she sings. I do a little bit of throat singing myself, but I won't subject you to it. What I will do is just sing a simple tone, and then I'm going to use the computer to select the overtones that are in my voice, so you can hear that they're present even though they're not selected. What the masters of this technique do is select those overtones using their mouth. Commentator Christian Juarez wrote in with this really amazing phenomena that I had to check out. He found that if he played two notes on the melodica close to each other, he heard a subharmonic bass tone that was also present. I'm a melodica player myself, so I ran to my instrument and pulled it out, and sure enough, there it was. Watch on the screen here as I play a high C note. You'll notice down in this region and in this region, there's no frequency content. Now I'm going to play an E flat above it, and likewise, there's still no content in these two regions. Now watch what happens when I play both of these notes at the same time. Where is this magic tone coming from? So this turns out not to be a psychoacoustic phenomena either, although we weren't sure at first. This is actually a tone being produced in the instrument. It happens in harmonicas too, and it's a pretty well-known phenomena there. Now this high C comes in about 1047 Hz, and this high E flat is about 1247 Hz. You may not be surprised to learn that the deep tone comes in at just about 200 Hz, which is the difference between these two notes. This is, in other words, a difference tone. And you see some other content here. One of these is the combination tone at 2294 Hz. But there are some other peaks as well. Now, I'm not exactly clear what this is. I think this might be something called heterodyne intermodulation distortion. The combination tones that we talked about before are a psychoacoustic phenomena. They are intermodulation distortion that happens in your ear when you hear two tones. This is an actual sound that the instrument itself is making. If we play these two notes and then start descending chromatically, you'll see that the bass tone moves with the descent. So now instead of a C in an E flat, which is a minor third interval, let's play a D in an E, which is a little bit narrower, a whole step interval. And you'll see that the subharmonic tone has now moved lower in frequency. If you're listening on a cell phone or a similar such device, you might have trouble actually hearing these low notes. They're pretty deep. It makes sense that the tone would be lower because the difference between the two notes is now smaller. So the difference tone is itself smaller. If we play an E flat and an E, now the tone gets really deep. It's really something to hear a tone this deep coming out of an instrument like the melodica. If you know something about the physics of how this is produced, I'd appreciate a comment below. I can see the beat frequency that's being generated by the combination of the tones causing a pulsing that would then set up sort of a resonant feedback in the air manifold of the melodica, but I don't really understand the combination tones or the other distortion products. So if you know how this might be happening on a physical level, please comment below. At any rate, it was a really neat thing to discover, so thanks very much, Christian Juarez, for commenting about it. I've been playing the melodica for a long time and I've never noticed. A lot of you wrote in to describe different effects that you heard having to do with triangle waves and sawtooth waves. I'm assuming this is the EDM producers out there. A lot of people listening to sawtooth waves. I wasn't able to reproduce most of the effects, but one that I got really excited about was described by commentator Physic Mad. Here's how it works. I'm going to play you 40 seconds of a sawtooth wave. Now this needs to be kind of loud. Obviously don't hurt yourself, don't make yourself uncomfortable with the volume, but make it a good strong signal. You're going to listen to it for 40 seconds. Preferably with headphones, although this might work on speakers, I'm not sure. And then at the end of that 40 seconds, it's going to immediately change to white noise. Now this is what white noise normally sounds like. You hear a wash of noise. There's nothing particular about it, nothing really changes. You might sometimes perceive little shifts of sounds, but generally speaking, it's pretty static. After we've listened to the 40 seconds of the sawtooth wave and it switches to the white noise, listen up in the higher frequencies and see if you can detect anything happening. Here we go. Well, what did you think? I love this effect. I think what's happening is that the sawtooth wave, with its very prominent harmonic series, is saturating certain frequency ranges of your ear. Then when we switch to the white noise, those frequency ranges are effectively notched out of what we're hearing. But we don't really notice that. White noise with notched frequency bands isn't necessarily something you can hear to the degree that you could identify what's happening. But then, as our ears start to warm back up to those frequencies, the psychoacoustic effect is that these frequencies are being added, and so we do notice them. And it sounds to my ear kind of like a really low bitrate, poorly made MP3. Or as Physic Mad described it, an artifact of DSP processing. Kind of sounds like the cymbals might sound if you were streaming something in the early 2000s on the internet. And that makes sense because that kind of frequency content is classically difficult for compression schemes to handle. This next one is another physics of audio demonstration, but it has some psychoacoustic implications. If you play a pure tone out of your speakers, say a 6K sine wave, and it's coming out of the left and right speakers equally, there will be places in the stereo field between those two speakers where those sound waves interfere with each other constructively or destructively. In other words, they'll get louder or could even theoretically go to complete silence. So when you move your head around in a stereo field, you can sometimes hear subtle shifts in the frequencies that you're perceiving. What we're going to do for this demonstration is take a small microphone. I'm going to play a 6K tone out of the speakers that you see, but what you're hearing is only what the microphone heard. Now listen as I move the microphone around in the stereo field, how dramatically this 6K tone can be boosted or cut. This obviously has some implications if you're a mixing engineer or a mastering engineer. If you're listening back to a mix and a certain tone seems to jump out, sometimes it's worth shifting your head a little bit just to make sure it's not some kind of positional effect happening. This is also why people spend so much time treating their rooms so that they're acoustically neutral as much as possible. Unless you're wearing headphones or earbuds, you can never overcome this effect totally. There will always be some kind of change depending on where your ears are in the stereo space. But the fact that our ears are a distance apart from each other means that they're not sampling exactly the same point in space. In the end, listening to complex music sources, it's not really a problem, but if you're listening to pure tones or you're really trying to pick out a frequency in a mix, it can throw you off. The last one I want to talk about is a trick used in the theme song to a video game called Doom Eternal. Composer Mick Gordon uses a really clever technique towards the end of the track. If you start listening to the track at about 4 minutes, you'll find that at 4 minutes and 20 seconds, something very special happens. If you're listening on speakers, you'll just continue hearing basically the same thing, what I can only assume is the sound of the tortured souls of the damned or something. But if you're listening on any device that mixes the stereo down to a mono signal, many cell phones do this, sometimes tablets and the like, or if you're listening on a system that is in stereo but has poor separation, then you'll hear something quite different. Now you should go and listen to Mick Gordon's version of it because they did a great job. But I'm going to try to reproduce it here, and I'll talk you through how it was made. I'm not going to get into all the gory details, but if you're an audio engineer of some kind, you shouldn't have any trouble filling in the gaps. We start with white noise. Now this is stereo white noise, meaning the left and right channels have different, independent white noise. It's not correlated with itself. If we mix this noise down to mono, it's just more white noise, except now that seems to be coming directly from the center. Let's pan it back out into stereo. Now what we're going to do is remove the mid and boost the sides. In other words, we're going to change this white noise so that it's the same white noise signal coming out of both sides, except that the polarity is reversed on one side. Now this does still just sound like noise, except if you're listening on headphones, you might notice a kind of strange feeling to it. Your ears are a little confused about what's happening, right? If we mix this down to mono, we get something very different. We get silence. Because the noise is perfectly correlated with itself, but in opposite polarity, it comes to zero when you add it up. Now what we're going to do is take a narrow frequency band only on one side, and we're going to flip the phase. What happens then, when you combine to stereo, is that everything goes away except for that narrow band where you flip the phase, because it's no longer canceling in the left and right channels. By employing this trick over and over again, we can actually play a little bit of a melody. Check it out. Now what you're hearing is me mixing down the stereo audio to mono so that you can hear it no matter what you're listening on. But if you want to hear this trick done for real, I'll play it at the end of this video. Again, if you're just listening on speakers, all you're going to hear is white noise. But if you're listening on something that has some degree of mixing down to mono happening, you should be able to pick the melody out. Pull it out at a party and impress your friends. Now why can't we hear the melody when the phase is changing on only one side? Well, basically we're not very sensitive to phase differences in general. If you go back to part 4, I demonstrate the Huggins pitch and the Kobovi cutting Maguire effect, both of which do involve us perceiving phase changes between the left and right channel, but it's not something that's a very strong effect or very noticeable. Okay, that's all I have for you in this video. Again, part 7 has been released at the same time, so check that out. I've got a brand new, mostly instrumental album of music that I'm about to release. I'm going to post videos of those tunes on my second channel, but on this main channel, I'm also going to post some breakdowns of those tunes where I talk about the music theory behind them, why I chose this chord, what key they're in, how I wrote the melody, that kind of stuff. Also coming up is a video on the headphone pitch shift effect. We talked about that in part 5 of the Psychoacoustics series, and a lot of you wrote in with very creative theories about what might be happening. I've tested them out, and I think I can convince you that they're wrong. See if you agree. That video will be coming out soon, too. Patreon link in the description. Thank you, Patreons. We are a small group, but we are mighty, and I appreciate you very much. See you next time.